Welcome to the Ethical Decision Making Session of the Unit of Competency, Work Within a Relevant Legal and Ethical Framework. By the end of this session, you should be able to understand ethical dilemmas, resolve ethical dilemmas, use problem-solving strategies to resolve ethical dilemmas, including those of a difficult nature, and you should be able to understand the need to follow the organisation's policies and procedures. In the workplace, we have lots of ethical responsibilities. Hopefully, you've already read about them. Some of them are listed here, but your code of ethics has the full list. They mostly work well together, supporting each other, but sometimes they clash. You might find yourself saying, I know I should maintain confidentiality, but I also know that I need to keep the kids in that family safe. In this case, the core principles of maintaining confidentiality and your duty of care are clashing. You might recall this example, this situation in the earlier session where we looked at your duty of care being balanced with your responsibility to maintain the client's dignity and their need for empowerment and the concept of their dignity of risk. I know that I should prevent harm wherever I can, but I also know that people can make their own decisions, even ones I don't agree with, or decisions that involve risk-taking behaviours. In this case, it's your duty of care and the need for the client dignity and empowerment that are clashing. Many workers have felt a clash between their duty to help their clients and their duty to look after themselves, thinking that although they should look after themselves, they've got so many clients that they feel that they need to help. And sometimes the dilemma isn't so much between two ethical principles as it is between an ethical principle and your own values. For some people, for example, their duty towards their family is a strong personal value, so they're tempted to discriminate rather than have a family member miss out. Or they might feel torn between their work and their co-workers. This can be especially hard to deal with. Other people's values aren't always the same as our own. And in these cases, it'd still go without saying that you should report anything you think is unethical to an appropriate person. Reporting dilemmas to an appropriate person could mean a member of senior management, some colleagues, health professionals, external agencies, law enforcement officers, or advocates and family members. We're going to be looking at the special privacy issues around referring to external agencies in a future session. And exactly how are you going to report? Well, you can report both verbally or in writing. Written reports have the added advantage that they provide a record that you've raised of the issue, but it's often more convenient to just report the issue verbally, say by phone or face-to-face. Written reports could be in the form of progress reports, case notes, incident reports, and so on. They should be a routine part of your work in most settings. Resolving these conflicts and working out what to do can be really tricky. Your life can be a whole lot easier if there's policies in place to tell you what to do. But sometimes it's not that easy. Policies might be missing, or you might need to make a decision without the support of a supervisor. Sometimes when you're dealing with a unique situation, your supervisor might not have encountered it before either. Various groups have come up with strategies to help in these situations. Here's a summary of one really good method from the Regional Youth Development Officers Network. You can check out the link for the full details. Their strategy says that you should preferably not do this alone. But ask yourself, preferably with a co-worker or supervisor, what the legal limitations are and if there's any limitations set by your agency policies. This step should help resolve most issues. For those it doesn't, it at least sets the limits for what we could do. Next, ask yourself, who are the stakeholders? List them. Yourself, your work, your clients, your organisation, the entire industry perhaps. Next, what are the ethical issues? Think about the power issues in particular. If you've got a lot of power in your situation, in your job, how much power have you got to do the wrong thing? And how can you avoid that? This sets the parameters for you deciding all the possibilities of what you could do. And the next step is, out of those possibilities, what should you do? This should be documented for a report of some sort so that your supervisors and your organisation knows how you made your decision. It really doesn't take that long. Let's take a look at how this process worked for a friend of mine. This is Chloe. She's got her first welfare job supervising a team of people, sorting second-hand clothes which have been donated to an op shop, so that they can be distributed to people living in poverty. On her first day of work, she found a jacket that someone had donated, and it was just her style, and it fitted beautifully. She decided she really would like that jacket. She just wasn't sure what the rules were about that sort of thing. Normally right about now, the obvious thing for Chloe to do would be to ask a supervisor or a manager, maybe an experienced co-worker. She could check if her job description had anything to say about it, and she could check the existing policies. These are usually written down, but they could include informal practices used by a small organisation or an individual owner or operator. But what can we do when we don't have policies and we can't rely on a supervisor or co-worker? This is the time to go back to the right-on ethical decision-making process. Now, we've started this process already by checking out the legal and policy limitations. Remember, ethical issues are rarely arising in isolation. There's often legal limitations and policies. Writing them into a report will help for future times this happens and ensures that management are aware of the process that you used. So, next, write down a list of all the people who are going to be affected by your decision. In Chloe's case, she thought about who's going to be affected. And she thought, first of all, herself, but also the customers may be missing out. And when she thought about it more, she realised that the organisation's reputation and perhaps income were going to be affected. The other workers would be affected. They'd be watching her for leadership, and that'd make a difference to how they decided. And the people who donated the clothes, they had a stake in it because they had an expectation as to what their clothes donation was going to be used for. Once she wrote the list down, Chloe realised it was a much longer list than she had originally thought. So she wrote down a full list of all the stakeholders she'd taken into account. Typically, they'll also talk about our need for integrity and having a lack of corruption, not benefiting yourself at the expense of clients, for example. By now, it should be starting to become clearer what the various options available to you are. For Chloe, she could take the jacket. No one's going to notice after all, but it does fail the test of whether it is legal or not. Option two, she could buy the jacket before it hit the store. That's probably legal, and it would satisfy many of the stakeholders. It wouldn't satisfy the expectations of the donors in her organisation who gave the donation believing it would benefit those in poverty. It could maybe meet their expectations if she gave a higher donation than normal. If she's taking this option, it would be important to make it extremely clear to all staff and management that she had paid, so as not to appear like she'd taken option one. Option three, she could let the jacket go out in the store for a period of time and buy it at the going rate, just like anyone else. It's a little bit different in that it's keeping with the donor's expectations. She'd still be using her knowledge to her benefit, possibly at the expense of a client, so that it wouldn't meet all of her ethical expectations. The fourth option is that she could let the jacket go to the clients as expected by all involved. If you've taken the legal, ethical and policy limitations into account and considered all stakeholders and possibilities, your final decision should be easier. Make sure you document the process you went through in case you're ever asked how you came to the decision that you did. Make life easier for the next person in the same situation. It makes sense to suggest a policy to the Board of Management so they can avoid this situation in the future. In Chloe's case, she decided that the jacket was donated so it would help people in poverty. So in her organisation, that meant it would be unethical to claim it for herself, and it went instead to a homeless client. Using this method, you should be able to resolve most ethical dilemmas that come your way when there's no policy or supervisor's guidelines to help you on the way. Take a look at the dilemmas we looked at earlier. We can look at the need to balance our ethical needs to look after ourselves and our desire to help beyond our ability. We could look at our ethical need to provide services to everyone equally and balance that with our family obligations. We could look at how to deal with situations where your co-workers or supervisors might be working unethically. In a later stage of this lesson, we will go through these scenarios in more detail. So, in summary, wherever possible, follow existing policies and procedures. Where there's an ethical dilemma, report that to your supervisor and work as directed. Where that's not an available option, work with a colleague to systematically resolve issues. Document your decision-making process and report to supervisors and or the board. You should now be able to understand ethical dilemmas, resolve ethical dilemmas, use problem-solving strategies to resolve ethical dilemmas, including those of a very difficult nature, and understand the need to follow the organisation.